Welcome to Medicine Matters Diabetes, Ask the Expert series. I'm Jay Shubrook, D.O., family physician and diabetologist. I'm joined today by Dr. Ian de Boer from the University of Washington, where he's an associate director of the Kidney Research Institute, a professor of medicine in the Division of Nephrology, and an adjunct professor in epidemiology. Dr. de Boer is an active investigator in diabetes complications, is a member of the ADA Professional Practice Committee, which makes the ADA standards of care, and the lead author of the ADA 2017 position statement on hypertension. Hello, Dr. de Boer. Thanks for joining us on Medicine Matters Diabetes.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
So for our Ask the Expert series, this is a series of interviews focusing on the practicalities of managing diabetes in patients with hypertension as well. Today, I'd like to talk to you about the ADA standards of care, and how do we keep up with these, and how do we engage these in our practice?
Well, the American Diabetes Association standards of care are intended to be a useful document that helps guide practice using the best available evidence and rational application to clinical care. It's put out every year, so there's an automatic updating process. The professional practice committee does oversee that process and update the standards every year. The goal is to keep them current, cutting edge, and a lot of effort is put into that. So the American Diabetes Association does a lot of the work. Of course, providers have to find those standards and apply them to their practice. In addition to the annual standards of care, the ADA does put out occasional position statements, which are more in-depth reviews of the state of knowledge of a current topic. For example, the hypertension standards of care, the hypertension position statement, which was put out this year, which was an update over a prior position statement published in 2003. Those are, again, more in-depth, comprehensive reviews of important topics that are meant to augment the standards of care that are put out on an annual basis.
Wow, that's really important. And I think, again, great guidance for us busy clinicians. So what would be the highlights regarding the main clinical guidelines regarding hypertension and diabetes?
So again, the hypertension position statement came out this year in the fall of 2017, and some of those new recommendations were actually incorporated into the 2017 annual standards of care. Those positions will again be incorporated into the 2018 annual standards of care. And in terms of highlights, I think there are a few. The first has to do with assessing blood pressure. So the ADA made a concerted effort to recommend increasing the use of home blood pressure monitoring. Patients, of course, live at home, and home and blood pressure monitor values can differ from those obtained in the clinic, and there's a clear new recommendation to use home blood pressure monitoring both for diagnosis and for monitoring and titrating of therapy. So that's one new highlight. Another highlight, I would say, is an update on the recommended targets for blood pressure treatment. And the ADA has recommended, again, targeting less than 140 over 90 for all patients with diabetes and hypertension, with, very importantly, an individualization component, considering different targets, including lower targets, depending on a number of patient-specific factors that I'm happy to discuss in more depth. And the third update that I think is important relates to the types of antihypertensive medications used to control blood pressure. And there's a slight modification of what was recommended before in the major classes of antihypertensives that we recommend for treating blood pressure.
Okay. So one of the things I noticed was that there was a recommendation regarding sometimes starting two medications at once. Tell me a little bit more about that.
Right. So when a diagnosis of hypertension is made, that's greater than 140 over 90, of course, what we want to do is confirm that diagnosis first by making repeat measurements on a separate day, usually multiple measurements on each of at least 2 days. And once we have a diagnosis made, there are two things we need to do for therapy. One is lifestyle modification. So the ADA does recommend, of course, that all patients with diagnosed hypertension have lifestyle modification. This is weight control, physical activity, alcohol moderation, etc. And then pharmacologic therapy. And most patients do require multiple medications to attain their individualized blood pressure target. If patients are in the 140 to 159 range systolic or 90 to 99 diastolic range, it's possible that one agent will obtain their blood pressure target sufficiently, and it's quite reasonable to start with a single agent. However, if they're markedly out of control or beyond their blood pressure target, so greater than 160 systolic or greater than 100 diastolic, one blood pressure agent is not likely to attain their blood pressure target at all, let alone quickly. So in order to get a more quick attainment of blood pressure target, we recommend starting with two agents. And that could be a single pill combination of two different classes of medication or two different individual medications from complement classes. And the rationale there, again, is that it's highly likely that more than one medication will be needed, and that starting two at once will get to goal more quickly.
Yeah, that's great. And you had mentioned that there are times where maybe 140 over 90 might not be the goal, that you might have a more aggressive goal in some patients. Who are the patients that we should achieve more tight control?
Right, so the ADA recommendations on individualization for blood pressure target really parallel those for individualization of hemoglobin A1C target. That's something that many clinicians are very familiar with. And maybe I'll back up and talk a little bit about hemoglobin A1C goal individualization. We have more information about how to do that than we do for blood pressure. So I think it's worth starting with that and using it as an example. The patients for whom we think we should have tighter glucose control by hemoglobin A1C are patients, first of all, who can derive the most benefit from that. And for hemoglobin A1C, that means the people for whom we can forestall microvascular and macrovascular complications over a long period of time. Also, very importantly, people who can safely achieve a low hemoglobin A1C. People who are at lower risk of hypoglycemia, who have better support structures in place, who can achieve their hemoglobin A1C goal with fewer medications, for example. So when we considered individualization of blood pressure targets, we leaned on the information that we know about individualizing hemoglobin A1C and extrapolated that to some extent to blood pressure. So what does that mean for blood pressure? First of all, who can benefit most strongly from a lower blood pressure? Well, the main benefit of intensive blood pressure control is reduction of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease events. So people who are at high risk of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease events, that is people who already have known atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease or have risk factors such as chronic kidney disease, older age, other comorbid complications that increase cardiovascular risk, those people may be patients that you consider a lower blood pressure target. At the same time, I think that how patients can tolerate more intensive blood pressure treatment is another element, the flip side of individualizing care. And people who are already on multiple medications, who are getting drug side effects or hypotension, otherwise cannot accommodate a low blood pressure target, of course, those are people that we want to back off on and maybe not treat so intensely. So I use an example of patients that I might see in my clinic. I have a nephrology clinic. About half of my patients have diabetic kidney disease. I can see patients who have a blood pressure of 137 over 70. Two patients, one might have monotherapy with lisinopril at a moderate dose, and have no problem with that. That's a patient that I would probably intensify therapy, pushing up the lisinopril dose and trying to achieve a lower target. Another patient who has the same blood pressure, 137 over 70, on five agents already, who's having difficulty taking these agents, mixing up the timing of their medications, having intermittent hypotension, and other drug side effects, it's unlikely I'm going to choose to intensify their blood pressure goal because I think they can't tolerate it. And that's just the tolerability side of things. course, we have to weigh in the potential benefits as well. So for each patient, there should be a process, really an individualized goal setting with the provider and the patient to determine what is the best blood pressure goal based on factors such as this. What is the potential benefit? What are the potential risks of trying to push the blood pressure lower?
So it always comes down to the art of practicing medicine, right? Balancing risk benefits and individualizing for every patient.
I think that's exactly right, Jay. You really have to take a personalized approach. Guidelines set an overview of the approach. This is what should be considered. But in the end, is an individual doctor-patient relationship really doing best for what's for the patient who's in front of you? It is an art, and this art needs to be applied carefully and in cooperation with the patient, of course.
And if the, our participants here would like to see the standards of care, how can they access them?
The standards of care are available from the ADA website for free. So they're made to be disseminated. They're made to be used. We would like them to be accessed frequently by providers in particular. That's the target audience, patients too. And they can be downloaded from the ADA website for free anytime.